Centering on a heart heartfelt response to a God who dared to humble himself and dwell among us. And so the Christmas season is time that we as Christians should humble ourselves. I mean, we should be humble, shouldn't we?
Yeah.
That God would wholly give himself to us. I mean, when it comes to God becoming flesh, he didn't just wade into the water. He high-dived. I mean, he took a plunge. Come on. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And so Jesus, the Son of God, became flesh for us. He entered this lost, simple, can I say, condemned world. And it says that he assumed the role of a servant. This is not a palace or a king. He was born in Bethlehem, raised in that. He assumed the role of a servant and Savior. And the people said,
amen.
Yeah. And he became obedient to the death of the cross, to die for our sins. And so the question every believer should ask, especially this time of the year, to ask himself or herself, am I wholly giving myself to God? Is that the question then? Only you can answer that.
Amen.
Only I can answer that. Am I wholly giving myself to God? William Carey, the famous missionary, said this, expect great things from God, attempt great things for God. And so the key to expecting great things from God and attempting great things for God is right in this, surrender. Wholly giving yourself to him. That is the power of one Lord and one holy yielded life, right? And so, as I returned from visiting the Philippines and Thailand, my mind, as I was coming back on the plane, it trickled, you know, flipping through the chapters. You've got, you know, you're on that sea bus, that air bus, you know, with all those people, and you're tired, but you're flipping through into the scriptures in your mind. And Acts chapter 17, verse 16 is where my mind settled. And so this is where we are. Verse 16, are you there? Paul finds himself alone. Okay, one. You got that? One. He's alone in Athens. Verse 16, see, begins, and while Paul waited for them in Athens, so the previous verses there in Acts 17 tells us that Paul has been driven from Berea by some troublemaking Jews, unbelieving Jews of Thessalonica, who presented his message of grace and the gospel. And so Silas and Timothy were there with him. And they sent Paul. You know, this is the way it is with Paul. Paul can't help himself. So, you know, you follow Paul through Acts, and either there was a riot or there was a revival. Because he just couldn't keep his mouth shut. So let's just get Paul out of the way. Send him to Athens. And so they did. He's ahead of them. He's left behind those two men to strengthen those young converts as they are facing persecution. And after arriving in Athens, evidently Paul said, okay, he sent word back, probably Facebook, to Berea, to his co-workers, and he's waiting. Okay, y'all got the picture. He's in Athens by himself, waiting for Silas and Timothy to join him. And so as Paul began to engage, I mean, he's not just sitting, waiting. He's active. And as he began to engage the people, as he began to take in the culture of Athens, Acts 17, 16 goes on to tell us that his spirit was stirred in him. And that phrase was stirred, one Greek word, paroxono, peroxide. I mean, we put the old hydrogen peroxide to an open cut. What happens? It bubbles up. As he engaged the culture, Paul's heart bubbled up. It describes a sudden outburst of uncontrollable emotion. So, well, what bubbled up in Paul? What was it that moved him? This is what the phrase that came to my mind. Look at it here. when he saw Athens wholly given to what? Idolatry. So that phrase, wholly given, there's the idea of being full of or concerned with something. That phrase, wholly given to idolatry. I want you to understand, that's the only time, only place in God's Word that this appears. Only here. There may have never been a more idolatrous city, let me say this, in the Western world than Athens. And repeatedly, Romans, Greeks, Jewish writers talk about the Athenian idolatry. For example, Greek historian Pausanias says this about the Athenians. He says, they greatly surpassed others in their zeal. Now, I want you to keep this in mind. Because don't you love God's Word? I mean, it's historically accurate. And this is from history. You look, check out the history in the Book of Mormon. Check it out. Check out the history in the Bible. You know what he said? Athens is full of religion. He went on to record that there were more idols in Athens than the rest of Greece combined. Pausanias wrote that the Athenians had altars dedicated to 12 gods at once. Now look at this. Look at the history here. To 12 gods at once, to what?
Unknown gods.
To what?
Unknown
gods and unknown gods. A Greek writer, Lucian, said, on every side there were altars and victims and temples and festivals. Roman Levy said this, Athens is full, he's the story, full of the images of gods and men adorned with every variety of material and all the skill of art. A Roman writer, Petronius, said, it's easy, I love this, it's easier to find a god in Athens than to find a person. Roman statesman Pliny states that he lived during the time of Nero, that Athens had over 30,000 public statues besides the countless private ones in the homes. Every gateway, every porch had a protecting god. They caught the eye, he says, at every place of prominence, there was an image. There was an idol. He says, even the agora, or the marketplace, Walmart. You couldn't walk into Walmart without seeing that. Greek historian, military leader, Xenophon, wrote that the Athenians had twice as many religious feasts as the other people. So, but what am I saying? You said we really overstate. Well, it's impossible to overstate. And I want you to understand, to get a grasp of the idolatry that was in Athens as he was home alone. Someone should make a movie. I mean, what is he talking about? For sheer size and volume, idolatry of Athens was beyond the pale. The volume, the number. There was no place in the Western world like Athens. And as we flew from the Philippines to enter Thailand, first time I've ever left Philippines to go to any other place besides home. But I went from there to Thailand, but that showed up big in my heart. And as we moved from the Philippines to Thailand, two things became very, very evident to me. First, Thailand was not as English-friendly as the Philippines. I mean, if you want to get a taste of Southeast Asia, and you've never left the county, and you're English only, then go to the Philippines. Good advice, makes anyway. And all the signs are written in English. It's very English friendly. You get to Thailand, not so much. Okay? I mean, that's the first thing that got me. But this is not really the main thing. Second, Thailand was not Christian friendly as the Philippines. I mean, in the Philippines, there are crosses and steeples and churches almost at every turn. I was enjoying almost in every hotel we were there. We would go in and out and whatever. It was Christmas music. And you'd go through through the Philippines and even in the town squares, life size, nativities. I'm not talking about the commercial Christmas. I'm talking about, the story, the nativity. And then when you leave there and then you set foot in Thailand, you realize not the land of Jesus. It's the name of Buddha. If there's any reference to Christmas in Thailand, it's the commercial. Hmm. Thailand is the land of Buddha, not Jesus. Several times I said, and Brother Floyd would bear witness, I said, he owns this country, Buddha. And I saw that Buddha was reigning, not Christ. And the whole spirit of the country was different. In Thailand, we saw the laughing Buddha. We saw the reclining Buddha. We saw the black Buddha. We saw the golden Buddha. We saw the female Buddha. I didn't realize there were so many Buddhas at every turn. There was either a Buddha, there was a spirit altar, a spirit house, or there was a statue to one of the renowned monks dotting the landscape. It just was different. It was painfully obvious that Thailand is a nation that is wholly given to idolatry. And so this message, however, is not Thailand, about Thailand, but the truth be known, and this is the truth. I don't care how this is going to sit with you. America is just as much a nation that's wholly given to idolatry. Our idols were just different. At the beginning of a 4 days ago, our nation. But we allowed our nation to set out and purge us of God's word and prayer. It was removed from the public schools, public places. And it's resulted in our nation's decline. Amen. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 18 says, where there is no vision. Actually, you have another translation. No clear word from God. No revelation is what it's saying. There's no vision, no clear pronouncement of God's word. Notice, the people perish or are taken. They cast off restraints. Right? But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. I was so amused. Was in a renowned one of the many temples. Yeah, take off your shoes. You one thing that Thailand has on this country, they still have reverence and respect for their leaders and for their religion. And there's nothing sacred in this nation. Hello?
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, you're going into this temple, and they got a list, and it says no tank tops, no. I thought I was at youth camp. You know, X. You don't go in here. And there's a couple of Americans even while we were there that mooned Buddha. Shine on the harvest moon. And so, you know, people were looking at us. And everywhere we went, we obeyed the rules. We did not make light of their religion. We respected it. And we need to do it. Didn't agree with them. But I wasn't going to dishonor them. Because you're not getting with that.
That's right.
But I want you to know, I mean, there's nothing sacred in this 21st century. Since we have a generation of people who embrace as truth the philosophy that says that there's no absolute truth. And so what do we have in America now? We have America as a land where and Christians do that which is right in their eyes. Come on.
Yeah.
Not God. So the knowledge of God, the knowledge of His Word is bleeding out of our culture. So what's happened? We've dethroned God and we've dethroned self. The greatest idol, just get a mirror.
Yeah.
That's all you need. It's all self-serving America. Come on. As you want it. So today as Christians, like Paul, we're challenged to communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ to a crisis culture. And it'll never happen until we are like Paul. And he is wholly given to God. Now put that together. A man wholly given to God is in a land that's wholly given to idolatry. And Paul was both deeply stirred and, can I say, disturbed by what he witnessed in Athens. No doubt, that's why he sent off to Silas and Timothy. Hey, guys, I need you here. I need you here. This place needs Christ. And although Paul was just one man in Athens, he began to expect great things from God. He began to attempt great things for God. Verse 17. Therefore, disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews. Now, that word dispute is an interesting word. Dialed, omahi, and then by that word, we get the word dialogue. Okay? It means to reason. It means to converse. It means to carry on a dialogue. So this is what he's doing in response to all that he saw. Paul listened to people's questions, and he responded with God's answers. And as Paul entered the city, we know his M.O. As he, in any city, read the book of Acts. He would, every city he'd go, the first place he would go would be the synagogue. And he would take the message of Christ straight to the Jews. You say, well, why is that? I'll tell you why. Christianity is the fulfillment of Judaism. The Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. The New Testament is the Old Testament concealed. It's one book. And so what is he doing? He's finding a place to get a foothold. He's finding common ground. Unbelieving people, but they at least they reverence the Bible. Come on. So he starts with the Jews. He has a dialogue. But not just the Jews. Notice. And with devout persons. And so what he's talking about here, and he has a dialogue with God-fearing, God-seeking Gentiles. And you find these people all through the book of Acts. Cornelius was a God-seeking Gentile. Lydia, Acts chapter 16, was a God-seeking Gentile. They were in the backyard of the Jews, but they were closer than they were. Come on. So he begins the dialogue with these devout Gentiles. Many of them were women. We're going to see that in a minute. Women that were prominent. He's giving and taking because he finds common ground. But notice, verse 17 continues, and in the market, what? Daily with them that met with him. That word market is agora. That speaks of the Walmart. That's the Times Square. That's the marketplace, you know? And so, on the street, whoever he happened to bump into, the average pagan in Athens, he would begin to talk. You know? And you know, talk about something and turn it to Christ. And so that's what he starts doing. And then verse 18. And certain philosophers of the Epicureans and the Stoics encountered him. And so the Roman world was greatly influenced by the Greeks. You had to know this, right? Greco-Roman, by their literature, their art. And so Paul began to engage another layer here of the culture. And that is the educated, the sophisticated elite that were in Athens. And so the Epicureans is an ancient Greek philosopher who founded the school or the philosophy is called Epicureanism. And so Epicureans were, well, let's just say they were materialists. They would laugh that Jesus would be the Son of God born of a virgin. They would just totally laugh at that. I mean, the Epicureans were about materialists. You ever know any of those? They believed that the present material world was all that there was for human existence. And then they live for the moment in the pursuit of a life free from pain and totally dedicated to experiencing pleasure. They said that in Athens, lining the streets and the temples were thousands of busts and sculptures. You know, the Greeks, they weren't exactly modest. Of the body, you know. Not mine. But, you know, Gary, yeah. Celebrated the human body. Sound like anything around here? It's all about pleasure. Stoicism, it was the ancient Greek philosophy which teaches the development of self-control and fortitude as a means of overcoming destructive emotions. So the Stoic sought to transform negative emotions into a life that's characterized by clear judgment and a calm, inner calm, freedom from suffering through voluntary abstinence, withdrawing from worldly pleasures. And the Stoics believed that God was found in nature. And Stoics embraced what could be called pantheism. And that is, well, there was a spark of divinity, right? In every living thing. We see the same philosophy today in earth worship, right? I'm talking to some ladies there in Thailand. They're talking about different types of jade. And so this one bring you fortune. This one bring you good health. This one, you know, you buy this rock.
Yeah.
And it'll change your life.
Oh.
Well, praise God, Jesus is the rock.
Amen.
But, you know, she was just thinking, you know, just get this and your life is going to be good. Now she's thinking, cha-ching! That's what she's thinking. But, you know, pantheism, polytheism. Verse 18. And some said, what will this babbler say? And others, some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods. Because, well, why did they say that? He preached unto them who? Talk to me. Jesus and the resurrection. So it's obvious that where the Paul conversed. And I love this. And put yourself right here. It's obvious that where the Paul conversed with the Jews or with the devout Gentiles or the average pagan that he would bump into at Walmart or whether it was the well-educated philosophers, I want you to know that his message was the same. His message was the same. It was the gospel. He preached the gospel of Jesus Christ, which included the resurrection, right? Paul was not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the power of God unto salvation. I mean, it's impossible to preach that Jesus was resurrected from the dead without first preaching that he died on the cross. And why did he die on the cross? I'll tell you why. Because we're born in sin and we're all sinners and we need a Savior.
Amen.
We need a Savior. And in response, they call him a babbler. Look at that. Interesting, when you look at that, it's called a seed picker. And what they had here in this accusation, well, he's this bird picking at the ground. You ever see a bird bobbing and picking at the ground? Pigeons. Pigeons do a lot of bobbing. Picking seeds. And he's just picking ideas. And he's just kind of convoluting, putting them all together like something that's profound. Something new. They were just laughing him off. I talked to a young man in the Philippines, a pastor, who said he was raised in a pastor's home. And he said, all my teenage life, I blew my dad off. I never listened to any of these messages. You know why? He was an unbeliever. That's why. In a pastor's home. He's an unbeliever. He might have checked off on all the baptism John could check, but he didn't have it in his heart. But then later on, he had an encounter with Jesus Christ. He got saved, and now he's a pastor. You know what he told me? I'd give anything to go back. Listen. When I had such opportunity. They called him Satan. Verse 19 through 21. And they took him, Paul, and they brought him to the Areopagos, saying, may we know what this new doctrine, whereof thou speakest, is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears, and we would know what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which are there spend their time in nothing else but to tell or to hear some new thing. And so Paul was given this great pulpit to present his message. And then the pagans. In other words, he was faithful in little things. In seemingly little things, opportunities. And so now he's in the special hill. It was a seat of judgment, where the astute, the sophisticated, educated men of Athens would gather sometimes to pronounce a sentence against criminals, but many times to entertain questions, serious questions about that had to do with religion. And so here's all of a sudden, they go from encountering the Stoics and the Epicureans to, hey, here, we want to hear you speak. Verse 22, and Paul stood in the midst of Marcia. Same Greek word, interesting, earlier. Areas, Pagos. We call it Marcia, translated into the King James Bible. Ye men of Athens, he says, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. Actually, better translated, very religious. So Paul knows his audience. And by the way, there's plenty of religion in Thailand. They're not lacking for religion. Come on. They're not lacking for religion most anywhere. Religion is everywhere. But obviously they need more than religion. He begins by acknowledging that they're very, very religious. Okay? So he builds on it. Verse 23. For as I passed by, I beheld your devotions. I found an altar with this inscription. What? Talk to me. Now isn't that what secular history authenticates? Check out your history in your Bible. That Bible, people who blow it off and say, well, it's just stories about that. You know, all that is that others, they haven't read it. Yeah. To an unknown God. Look at this. Whom therefore, this is so good. Whom therefore you ignorantly worship, I declare, him I declare in you. So it's here, you might say that he cuts to the chase. He confronts them with the difference between fables and speculation and fabrication and the truth that is based on God's revelation. And while Paul doesn't set out to be intentionally offensive, I tell you what, he is not afraid of exposing error by clearly presenting the truth. And by the way, our Savior plainly said, I am the way. He didn't say a way. I am the way, the truth, and what? No man comes to the Father, what? Don't be ashamed of the exclusivity of Christianity.
Amen.
Well, if I say that it's only through Jesus they're going to be offended. Well, it's not good that I don't want you to offend people. That, you know, don't move Buddha. But we must never apologize for the truth. Well, I disagree with you. No, actually, you're disagreeing with Jesus. Because that's what he said. Did you see that? You know, have you been in a conversation with someone and it's going and then you pivot in that conversation and turn things toward truth? Have you ever been there? Paul goes on to do just that. He begins to share the truth concerning the God of the Bible. Look in verse 24. God that what? Made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is what?
Lord
of heaven and earth. That's huge. I mean, the God of the Bible is bigger, greater, more powerful than they ever imagined. God alone is creator of all things. Let me have an amen on that. He is separate from, he is supremely above, and he is sovereign over the universe, all creation. Verse 24 continues, he dwells not in temples made with hands. Verse 25, neither is worship with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth life to all life and breath to all things. So these philosophers of Greece were unable to conceive of any real distinction between God and the created universe. My Bible tells me this. In Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Now, in the old ancient Hebrew, that meant the cosmos. That meant the universe. And that word created, you must understand, do some word search on that. Do some study. It has the idea of bringing something out of nothing.
Yeah.
The best commentary on the Bible is the Bible. So Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3 adds, though through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, His divine fiat, Word of power, so that things which are seen are not made of things which do appear. God is separate from and above His creation. God reveals Himself in His Word as the great I Am, the self-existent, eternal, changeless One. I want you to understand, God needs nothing to sustain Himself. This universe were to go away, and it will one day.
Yeah.
God will still be God.
Amen.
Now, the universe needs Him.
Yeah.
He doesn't need it. He sustains. This is the God of the Bible.
Amen.
And God doesn't need anything. He sustains everything. The universe needs Him. And by the way, so do you.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Paul's doing a good job, isn't he? He's got this great pulpit, and he said, let me tell you about your God that you ignorantly worship. Verse 26. and hath made of one blood all nations of men, for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times of a world appointed at the bounds of their habitation. So Paul tells them that everything that is or exists comes from God. Oh, by the way, which includes all of humanity. You know what this Bible clearly says? There's just really one race of men. It's called the human race. And mankind was created exclusively by and for God. And it's God who determines our appointed times and the reach of our existence and the reach of our influence upon the earth. I mean, you know, you're in that big Airbus and you're somewhere over the Pacific and you have turbulence, you know, and you know, I don't know about you, but I have a default to fear. How many have a natural default to fear? But I thought to myself, if God wants me home, I'll be home. If not, God is still God. And that's what it says here. You're not going to die one day earlier than God allows you. There's a time to be born and there's a time to die. And aren't you glad you don't know the last? Or how? Now think on that. Acts 17, verse 27 to 28. That they should seek the Lord, if happily they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain of your own poets have said, for we are his offspring. So Paul tells us that humanity does not seek after God on their own because of their own sinfulness, but rather that humanity, now listen to this, this is Romans 1. Humanity by nature knows that God exists. Why? Because in him and not him, we move and we have our being. And by the way, let me tell you something about creation. He created humankind different than all other creation. We are the objects of his personal created. And the height, because we're created in his likeness. Come on. Talk to me. An image. Rehimatu's brother-in-law is here. We welcome you. Just stepped off the plane. Really from Africa, right? And now he's here. I said, welcome to America. And especially, welcome to Texas. God bless Texas. That should be in the Bible. Aren't you glad he's here?
Amen.
Every human being is worthy of dignity and respect. Come on. Hold your hands up like this. We all bear the image and the likeness of our God. We are body, soul, and spirit. God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We have volition. It's sad. It's a travesty. And you listen to this, Pastor. I've said it before. And I mean to say it, but forgive me. I haven't been here in a while. It's a travesty in America that it's the military and the sports arena that has integrated this nation. And that's a shame on the Lord's church. I love it. Silence. Thanks for the affirmation. Shame on Christianity, because that verse has been there all the time. Because people have culturally translated and interpreted their Bible and don't let it just say what it means. It means what it says. Come on. And you know what? We're all the image of God, our Creator. And we're all born theists. Not atheists. It's not natural to be an atheist. It's not natural to be an agnostic, because creation itself bears witness that God the first cause. And we are the effect. And the people said, verse 29, for as much as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the God has likened to gold and silver or stone given by our man's device. See, you see God, you can just see Paul in Athens. It's God who spoke all things, all time, matter, and space into existence. And only God can create something out of nothing. And therefore, it's absolute foolishness to think that God can't be reduced to chunk of stone or wood or an image. Come on.
Yes.
So here Paul once again declares the message of the gospel. Verse 31, 30 and 31, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth men all where, everywhere to what? Talk to me. Repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness, that man whom he hath ordained, wherefore he hath given assurance unto all men that he hath raised him from the dead. So Paul has revealed, God has revealed himself to humanity, not just through creation. Read Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. God has not just revealed himself through creation. God has just not revealed himself through his word. God has supremely revealed himself through a person. The Lord Jesus Christ. And how do we know that Jesus was the right one? I'll tell you why. On the third day he rose from the grave.
Amen.
That's what he's saying. Paul restates the truth of the resurrection. And then he calls them to repentance. Paul didn't water down. He didn't compromise his message to this astute audience. He spoke the plain and simple message of the gospel. Let me put it together for you here. Number one, God created us. Number two, sin separates us from a righteous, thrice-holy God. Number three, only through the completed work of Jesus can we have a right relationship with God. Number four, unless we come to know God through Jesus Christ, we face inevitable judgment. And that's what he just said. That's what he said. There's a day appointed. Verse 32. How did they respond? Yup. Even here this morning, people blowing me off. Even this morning. And when they heard the resurrection of the dead, some what? They laughed. Verse 32 continues, another said, what? Well, we'll think about that. They weren't convinced, but they said, I don't think about this. Verse 33 and 34, so he departed from among them. How did certain men cling to him? And what?
Believed.
Among the Anios, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with me. Aren't you glad that someone listened?
Yes.
And you know, it says that, you know, the language here is just like Paul finished, and you know, you got your jeering people, and you got the others who just walked away and said, well. And then Paul walked away. And then as Paul came down off that hill, there's two people. Isn't it great that God listed a man and a woman?
Amen.
Mr. Paul, could we talk? Mr. Paul, could you talk to me a minute about what you said? And the same spirit that stirred Paul stirred their hearts. And they believed. And the people said,
amen.
The city that was wholly given idolatry had now encountered one man who was wholly given to God. Some of them said that God's not called us to be successful. He's called us to be faithful. And for sure, Paul was faithful. Aren't you glad that his faithfulness resulted in the people being saved? And some say that Paul was out of place, and he was out of his league. as you stood to proclaim Christ in this ancient citadel of human knowledge. But I believe, now I believe that Paul was like Little Caesar's pizza. I believe he was hot and ready. Right? I believe he was. Pepperoni. I believe he was hot and ready.
Amen.
I believe he was, I think he was just on a trigger. One of those quick triggers to. First Peter 3:15. Now I don't think I even want to go there yet. I'm going to go to Psalm 119. Verse 98. For through thy commandments hast thou made me what? Wiser than what? For they are ever with me. I have more understanding than what? Don't ever be intimidated. For thy testimonies are my medicine. If God can use Paul, here's the bottom line. He can use you. And all that is required of us is to tap into the power of one Lord and one Savior. Paul's example challenges us to dialogue every day. Now, this message has got a conclusion. And I've got an appeal. And let me tell you what it is. Based on what we talked about. That we ought to be in the marketplace.
Yes.
Talking to people who just stepped off of a plane back from Africa. I love doing this. Oh, I noticed the accent. Where does it come from? Right? Well, as a matter of fact, and that's where you start. Dialogue to whoever. This is where we need to start. Come on. Now we go to 1 Peter 3:15. But what's the word? But what? What does that mean? Talk to me. Set apart. Does that mean like holy given? Well, sanctify, look at this, the Lord God where? So there we go. Here's where we start. Be holy given to God. And then you'll what? Be hot and ready. Are y'all with me?
Yeah.
Hot and ready. Always. Look at that. That's huge. Always. When you feel good, are you hot and ready? I mean, you know, when you got a headache, when you got your list and you're busy. Oh, you know what? The greatest opportunities for dialogue is when we're so busy. We just don't have time. How many ways you're here? You're guilty of that.
Yeah.
You're just... How many have gotten on the other side and said, man, I should have had a V8. You get on the side and you said, God prompted me. And I pushed him away. Now, people, look at me. That's why we're here.
Amen.
We're not here just to look pretty. We're not just here like the Epicureans to have pleasure. It's not about us. It's not. And this is where this sermon is coming. Sanctify the Lord God in your heart. And be ready always to give an answer to every man. A reason of the hope that
yes.
is in you. And by the way, how you do it makes a lot of difference. With what? Meekness. Paul's example inspires us to grasp the power of one holy given to God. And so like Paul, we must know what we believe and why we believe. Are you with me?
Yes.
We've got to know what we believe. Second, we've got to know what other believe. Third, we'll always be willing and ready to share our faith with anyone and everyone. And fourth, never be discouraged.
Yes.
Now let me say this. You cannot witness and fail. You can only fail to witness. You can't dialogue and fail. Well, he didn't. Well, not everybody believed Paul. And by the way, not everybody believed Jesus.
Yes.
Never be discouraged, but remain faithful to God. Wherever he has placed us, do you desire for God to use you? Does God have your whole heart? And so that's where we are. And that's why we're here. I don't know. I don't know how much time I have left on this earth, and neither do you. But I know this, that while we have breath in our mouth, we need to have a ready answer. To engage whoever God sets before us. Let's pray. As we end this time in your word, this word is not important what we think or what I say. But Lord, I've tried to be very faithful to unpack what you have said. And I thank you, dear Father, for Paul, who had such courage and was willing, the one, just one man, waiting on help, but was willing to just start and engage a culture for you. And it's so obvious, Lord, that you were with him. And may we make the connection this morning that you're with us. And that our culture is no different. And that our purpose is no different. And so, Father, would you call believers? Would you burden us for whoever is in front of us? May you convict us where we give you a part of our lives, but not a whole. We let you in some rooms of our house, but not all. Lord, you died for us. So, this Sunday, stir us like you stirred Paul. And Lord, if there's one here who is lost and has never come to terms with your great Savior, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Oh, I pray that they'll be drawn to commitment. Maybe it's baptism. Maybe it's church membership. Maybe that it's just being free from sin and covered in your righteousness. Never know it. You are Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Oh, move us this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As we stand.